My name's Max Feinstein, and I'm an anesthesia resident at the Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City. On a given day at work, I frequently will administer opioids like fentanyl to my patients who are undergoing painful surgeries. Which begs the question, am I contributing to the opioid epidemic in the United States? If you find this video interesting or helpful, I'd really appreciate it if you liked it and subscribed to the channel. Let's dive in. This is also the perfect opportunity to point out that this video is not medical advice, so if you do have questions related to your healthcare, you do need to talk to your own doctor. Before we get too far, we should define the terms we're talking about, which can sometimes be confusing. So the word opioid refers to any substance that stimulates opioid receptors, for example, mu receptors, that are located on cells that are primarily in the central nervous system. Another term you'll hear is opiate, which is a specific type of opioid that's a natural derivative of the poppy seed. Specifically, that includes heroin, morphine, and codeine. And the final term that you'll hear commonly thrown around is narcotics. That term has several different meanings in common parlance. One of those meanings is a substance that is mood altering. And the other definition is a substance that is specifically illicit in nature. For simplicity and correctness, in this video, I'm going to stick to the term opioid because it describes all of the medications I'll discuss that agonize the opioid receptors. The opioid epidemic is an enormous problem in the United States, as illustrated by the fact that in the past 20 years, nearly 500,000 people have died in an overdose that involved an opioid. As this graph from the CDC shows, this problem has only gotten worse over time. All of this begs the question of, if opioids are such a problem in the United States, then why are they administered by doctors during surgery? It's an even more poignant question when you consider a patient who's under general anesthesia and is therefore unconscious and not having any subjective experience of pain. So why do they need to receive medications that reduce pain? A big part of the answer is that even though a patient is unconscious under general anesthesia and not having any subjective experience of pain, there still is an objective experience where the body reacts to a painful stimulus. For example, if a surgeon makes an incision with a scalpel, even though the patient isn't aware of that, their body will still have a physiologic response that might include tachycardia and hypertension. For a patient who's healthy and doesn't have any cardiac pathology, for example, it might not be problematic to have a sympathetic response to a painful stimulus. However, for somebody who does have cardiac pathology, where the heart is very sensitive to any sort of changes in oxygen supply and demand, well, a big incision from surgery can cause a sympathetic response that leads to an increase in oxygen demand, which the heart might not be able to provide. And in the worst case scenario, uncontrolled pain, even if not subjectively experienced, can precipitate something like a myocardial infarction. This is just one type of problem that could arise due to an uncontrolled sympathetic response to a painful surgical stimulus. Other examples include a cerebrovascular accident that could occur secondary to an acute increase in blood pressure. And this hypertension can also lead to practical issues for the surgeon. For example, increased amount of blood in the surgical field, or even something like ruptured suture lines if a surgeon has carefully sutured together, for example, blood vessels that, if they're subjected to too much pressure, could rupture. These are some of the more catastrophic reasons that it's really important for anesthesiologists to make sure that pain is well controlled, even under general anesthesia. But something that's just as important is making sure that once the surgery is all done and the anesthesia is discontinued, that the patient wakes up comfortably, because after all, having a surgery is painful and that pain will persist after surgery. So helping the patient get their pain under control before they wake up is an extremely important part of the anesthesiologist's job. As an aside, it's worth pointing out that opioids in and of themselves do not produce memory loss, also known as amnesia. So if an anesthesiologist is formulating a plan where they want their patient to not remember anything, then other medications will need to be included. For example, isoflurane or sevoflurane, which are both inhaled anesthetic gases, or an IV agent like propofol or midazolam. You might be wondering about alternative analgesics or pain relievers that can be used during surgery, and so one that's commonly employed is Tylenol. But as you can imagine, that's not an especially strong pain reliever, but it still can be used as part of an anesthetic plan. Another class of medications that's commonly used as an adjunct for analgesia are the NSAIDs, or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. But their utility is somewhat limited by an increased risk of bleeding, which is especially problematic during surgery, and an increased risk of kidney damage, so they need to be used judiciously. Opioids like fentanyl, remifentanil, hydromorphone, and so forth are used extremely commonly as part of an anesthetic plan. And if you'd like to see specific examples of what I've actually administered to patients undergoing painful spine surgeries, then check out this video that I've linked right here. Given how commonly opioids are administered as part of anesthesia, there has been a lot of research investigating the extent to which that contributes to the opioid epidemic. The bulk of the research on this topic centers around a specific question, which is looking at whether or not there's a relationship between the amount of opioid that's administered during surgery and the amount of opioid that a patient takes in the post-surgical period. A slew of very robust research articles have been published, especially in the last several years, and basically have concluded that the amount of opioid administered during an anesthetic has no relationship with the amount of opioid that a patient takes after surgery. However, one important finding that shouldn't be overlooked is that a reduction in intraoperative opioid administration is related to a reduction in postoperative nausea and vomiting. Over the last decade or so, there's been a lot of interest in exploring whether alternative non-opioid medications could be administered in place of opioids to control sympathetic responses during surgery. However, it's important to keep in mind that basically any medication that a patient receives has some sort of risk associated with it, even if it's not related to opioids themselves. This was illustrated by a recent study that compared a group of patients receiving standard anesthetic care using an opioid versus patients who received anesthetic care where the opioid was substituted for a different medication that can control a sympathetic response. And specifically, that's a medication called dexmedetomidine. One of the side effects of dexmedetomidine is bradycardia, or decreased heart rate. And during this study, the group of patients who was receiving dexmedetomidine actually had 3 instances of bradycardia that resulted in cardiac arrest, and the study had to be stopped prematurely. There are other strategies that anesthesiologists frequently use to decrease the amount of opioid that needs to be given during surgery, and one of those strategies is using regional anesthesia, which is the injection of local anesthetic into areas surrounding nerves that go to the surgical site. There is strong evidence that regional anesthesia does decrease the amount of opioid that's given during a hospital stay, but it's also worth pointing out that regional anesthesia also carries risks along with it. So basically, everything that we do has risks, and there needs to be a conversation between the doctor and the patient about the risk-benefit profile of all of the options that are available for anesthesia. You know, at the risk of making this video too American-centric, it might be interesting to talk with an anesthesiologist in another country and get their perspective. Hi, operator, can you connect me with an anesthesiologist outside of the United States? Australia, like Outback Steakhouse? Yeah, that's fine.
Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, hello. Who is this?
Hey, this is Max Feinstein. I'm an anesthesia resident. Who's this?
Oh, this is Lahiru. Max, you're not on YouTube, are you?
Yeah. Oh, wait, are you on YouTube? Are you ABCs of anesthesia?
Yeah, how did you call me? What's going on? How'd you get my number?
The hospital operator called. That's wild. Well, I really just had a question for how people do anesthesia outside the United States. Is that something you can weigh in on? Are you free right now?
Yeah, anesthesia in Australia. Look, we do everything upside down, but besides that, it's pretty similar, I think.
Logically. Well, so I'm making a video about opioids. You guys have opioids? They make it across the ocean to you guys?
Yeah, we definitely have opioids, and it's funny you should say that because they're a bit of a problem, aren't they?
Definitely here. Is that a problem for you guys too?
Yeah, so I mean, it first became known to me because one of your mates, John Oliver, from New York, he did a whole piece on it, And some crazy statistic, I think in the US, like 1% of people discharged with opioids will become addicted to it. That's some really kind of horrifying statistic. And Australia's not too different. Like our version of the FDA, so the TGA, the Therapeutic Goods Administration, they came up with this really sad fact now that in Australia, there's more deaths from prescribed opioids, legally prescribed opioids, than illegal opioids like heroin, which is insane. That's like 3 deaths per day. You know, just a really sad statistic. So yeah, it is definitely a problem here.
I'm curious. I know that it is probably difficult to quantify this, but if you were providing anesthesia for, again, a routine appendectomy for a 70 kilo, 30-year-old patient, roughly how much and what opioid would you administer to that patient during surgery?
For the induction, most people would give alfentanil or fentanyl, and say most people would give in the range of, you know, 1,000 to 2,000 micrograms of alfentanil, or they'd give, you know, 100 to 200 micrograms of fentanyl, and that's, you know, just for the intubation. But there's a big trend towards giving fentanyl. Like, we, you know, each anesthetist will probably just take out a 500 microgram vial of fentanyl at the start of the case, and then, you know, give 100, 200 at the start, and then titrate 50 mics per every 15 to half an hour for the rest of the case. So, you know, if the case went for an hour, you'd get maybe another 100 to 200 mics. But if it did go longer, if it was a complicated lap collie or complicated procedure, you might end up, you know, giving the full 500.
Yeah, that's fascinating. What you're describing is basically exactly the same type of dosing regimen that I would use.
Hey, do you use much remifentanil?
We use a lot of remifentanil. We have a very robust ENT department at my hospital in particular, and find that the pharmacokinetics of remifentanil are very favorable for surgeries that are very stimulating intraoperatively and then have very little postoperative pain. So having a medication like remifentanil that's fast acting and quick to be metabolized is an excellent option for those types of cases. So yes, we do use remifentanil quite frequently in our hospital.
Yeah, nice. Yeah, we find that, yeah, I totally agree. Like I'd pretty much use it routinely for the ENTs and the turbinectomies, and, you know, you get less blood loss, better surgical view and all that kind of stuff. But then if we ever see, so if the pain guys, like we've got a bunch of really great pain doctors in our team in anesthesia in Melbourne, and if they ever see you running remifentanil during other cases, like, you know, big laparotomy cases, they'll probably just be like, why are you doing that? You know, they're always worried about the, you know, hyperalgesia effects of remifentanil.
Yeah. Is cost something that you guys think about at all? And at the risk of making this video extra controversial now, because I have gotten some very, let's just say, spicy comments on a video that I made about providing anesthesia for spine surgery, in which remifentanil was prominently featured, and there was a corresponding relatively higher cost associated with that medication. Is that something that comes into consideration at all when you're coming up with your anesthesia plan?
Yeah, but fortunately, the opioids pale in comparison to the other costs of our department. So I think Sugammadex is pretty expensive for us overall. Metaraminol is a huge cost, and maybe propofol, just from, you know, just the commonness of use, and it's pretty much the only game in town for IV inductions for us. But so we don't think about it too much. And I've got to say, most people just aren't using remifentanil with any kind of frequency that's probably gonna stir that problem up at all. Cost is definitely a big thing, but not for remifentanil.
Interesting. Well, could be a topic for a future video of ours.
Future video, yeah. That's right.
Well, I really appreciate your time. Thanks for taking this collect call, because I wouldn't like to charge this to my hospital since I'm calling from the landline. So it's very, very generous of you with your time.
Hey, just pay it forward. No problems at all.
Well, it's great to talk with you, and I'll be sure to check out your channel and point my viewers towards your channel as well, because you produce excellent content that is absolutely worth watching.
Oh, thanks so much. Thanks. And likewise, you too. And you know, I'm going to have to give you a call sometime during one of my videos and get your perspective. So yeah, look forward to the next one. See you, Max. Have a good one.
All right, you too. Well, that was interesting. And if you enjoyed this video, you might want to check out this video where I narrate all of the commonly used medications as part of a general anesthetic. Thanks very much for watching. See you next time.